has my wholehearted support. I am confident that it will have the support of every American. The situation in Europe is grim and forbidding as winter approaches. Despite the vigorous efforts of the European people, their crops have suffered so badly from drought, floods, and cold that the tragedy of hunger is a stark reality. The nations of Western Europe will soon be scraping the bottom of the food barrel. They cannot get through the coming winter and spring without help, generous help, from the United States and from other countries which have food to spare. I know every American feels in his heart that we must help to prevent starvation and distress among our fellow men in other countries. But more than this, the food saving program announced tonight offers an opportunity to each of you to make a contribution to the peace. We have dedicated ourselves to the task of securing a just and a lasting peace. No matter how long and hard the way, we cannot turn aside from that goal. An essential requirement of lasting peace is the restoration of the countries of Western Europe as free, self-supporting democracies. There is reason to believe that these countries will accomplish that task if we aid them through this critical winter and help them to get back on their feet during the next few years. They must do most of the job themselves. They cannot do it if thousands of their people starve. We believe they can and will do the job if we extend to them that measure of friendly aid which marks the difference between success and failure. Their most urgent need is food. If the peace should be lost because we fail to share our food with hungry people, there would be no more tragic example in all history of a peace needlessly lost. Another reason for conserving food is to aid in controlling inflationary spirals and in preventing undue price burden for our people at home.
Never believe it. Well, Jerry, let's take a look at the underside of yours, too. By the way, does your car have knee action?
Yes.
Operates the same way, I suppose, that ours does. All right, now let's turn her back and take a look at your brake. Do you have the same type of brake, or does it operate a little bit differently from ours? Well, his pressed down up in the front of the car, as I remember it.
I got a lever here.
Oh, we're looking at the wrong end.
I got a foot lever. It pulls this cable, and it gives you a mechanical advantage.
I know that the best man, the best design, will win in the Soapbox Derby. So my best wishes to you, and my congratulations, gentlemen, for such fine students.
Well,
good night to you all.
This is the way we make citizens.
He's got lots of bite, too. There goes the bite again. Brockman steps outside the ring, and so Goodney has to break it up. Goodney just said over our shoulders to Simba Parker, is this a fighting match or a wrestling match? Punch in the stomach. Get over there. We're going to give this match to Goodney when he succeeds in pulling the hair of Parker. That's Goodney now getting into it with Parker. As far as it did, Commissioner Halpern, in charge of wrestling, is here tonight. And usually when you lift your hands to a referee, you're a dead pigeon.
This is the National Broadcasting Company. Good evening. This is Ed Herlihy speaking. Each week, Kraft, makers of fine cheeses, including that favorite of connoisseurs, McLaren's Imperial Cheese, presents the Kraft Television Theater. Tonight's play is I Like It Here, a comedy by A.B. Schifrin. As Willy Kringle, the refugee from Middle Europe who likes it here, we are happy to have Stefan Schnabel, who was last seen in Around the World in 80 Days. Also featured in our cast tonight are Alice Yarman, Sherling Oliver, Betty Bueller, Arthur Franz, Mel Brandt, and Leopold Badia. That's the telephone ringing in Professor Merriweather's home, someplace in New England. Things in the Merriweather home are in a normal state of confusion. The weekend guest this week has been Captain LaRue. And that's the captain's bag there. He's just about to leave. The object next to the bag is a man named Smedley.
Oh, Mother, Captain LaRue's leaving. The taxi's here. Oh, all right, dear. See if you can find your father.
Jack!
That's the captain's bag, Mr. Smedley.
Hello? Dad!
That's the captain's bag, Mr. Smedley. I'm sorry, but I've already hired a man.
Dad!
Well, the wages are $100 a month.
Oh, Dad!
Oh, yes, a very nice apartment right off at the garage. But I told you, I've already hired a man.
I can't find him anywhere.
Yes. Yes, he's an American, too. I'm quite sure that he's the man I want. Goodbye. Oh, dear.
Goodbye, Captain LaRue.
He's gone.
Oh, my garage!
Mr. Smedley, why didn't you help with the captain's baggage?
Nobody told me to help.
Well, don't you ever do anything until you're told.
You said I was to begin work tomorrow morning.
Well, that's right, Mr. Smedley. Now that you're one of us, won't you do something for me today? Now, I'm expecting another guest this afternoon, a Russian poet, and I'd be so grateful if you'd carry his bag. Now, will you do that for me?
I guess I can do that.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Smedley. What a shame the captain couldn't wait to meet Sir Shabonikov. Oh, a Frenchman and a Russian right in this room. If there's one thing I love, it's to promote friendly relations between foreigners. Well, come along, Mr. Smedley. I'll show you where your room is. It's right over the garage.
I can't find Dad anywhere.
Oh, that's a shame, dear. What was it we wanted him for?
Oh, Mother. Hey, there. Dad, we were looking all over for you.
Is that Frenchman gone?
You know darn well he's gone.
Good.
Why didn't you want to say goodbye to him?
Because I never said hello.
Uh-uh, come on, get them off the table. You know Mother doesn't like your feet there.
Your mother, Laura, doesn't like my feet any place.
Oh, gosh, I ought to go get dressed. I'm going to have cocktails and dinner with David.
Who's David?
Well, you know him, Dad. David Bellow, my boss.
Am I to understand that you have chucked the Monroe boy?
No, Brad chucked me.
I don't believe it.
He insulted Mother and we quarreled.
Brad insulted your mother?
Yes, he said.
you know she's into it. And the machine smashes her hand.
Am I married to a dumb woman, Bella, in addition to all else? I advise you to answer me.
I don't understand you. You're talking round and round. My head is going round and round.
You don't have to tell me that. Now, please. What was it? A moment ago, I asked if you remembered.
You asked me if I remembered what you said you would do to me if I did not find the bill.
Admirable, my dear Bella. Admirable. And what was it I said I would do to you if you did not find the bill?
You said you would lock me up.
Yes, and you believe me to be a man of my word, don't you? Did you look for that bill?
Yes.
Where did you look for that bill?
Around the room.
Around the room. Where? Around the room. In my desk, perhaps.
No, not in your desk.
Why not in my desk?
Your desk is locked.
Do you imagine that you can lie to me?
I am not lying.
Bella. Bella, come here. Your dark, confused, wandering mind has led you into playing some pretty tricks tonight, has it not?
My mind is tired. I want to go to bed.
Of course your mind is tired. It's so tired that it doesn't work at all. You don't think, you dream everything all day long. Don't you know that? You sleepwalking imbecile. What kind of a dream did you have tonight? Where did your mind wander that you split open my desk? What diseased dream did you have tonight, eh?
Dreamed? Are you saying that I dreamed all that happened?
All that happened when? Tonight? Of course you dreamed all that happened. Or rather, all that did not happen.
I didn't dream. I didn't. For God's sake, don't tell me I dreamed.
Sit down and be quiet. What was this dream you had? You interest me.
I dreamed of a man.
You dreamed of a man?
I dreamed of a man.
What sort of man? What man did you dream of? Pray tell, Bella.
A man. A man came in here. Let me rest. Let me rest.
Bella, pull yourself together. Who was this man you dreamed of?
I dreamed of a man. I dreamed of a man.
I know you dreamed, you gibbering idiot. I want to know more about this man of whom you dreamed. Do you hear me? Do you hear me?
I dreamed!
Was I any part of this curious dream of yours, Mrs. Manningham? Perhaps my presence here will help you to recall it.
Today we have all our old friends with us, all our steadies, our regulars. Among them, Sandra Gale, who's shown you how to lengthen wardrobes, how to decorate everything in the home. And today she's going to show you home care of clothes, which is really very important and very interesting to everyone, I'm sure, to the men also. And of course, Martha Logan will be in the Swift Test Kitchen as she always is, and she's cooking up something exciting as usual.
And also, I think you're going to make a lot of new friends today. You're going to have a chance to match your wits out there, you televisitors, to match your wits against the wits of famous experts in an IQ contest. You remember we had one several weeks ago. Well, we're going to have it again today. But, Jinx, before that, we've got some fashion department.
Yes, before the IQ and everything, we're going to take our first department will be a stroll along Fifth Avenue, where we'll take a look at the very latest styles. And as usual, it's going to be through the eye of fashion. This lovely dinner dress is a Varden Petite, designed especially for you small feminine girls who are 5'5" or even under. The fine detailing of this linen-type lace dress makes it top fashion news. Notice the delicate flattery of the tiny rolled collar that so cleverly follows the scallop design of the lace. And of course, the silhouette is as new as tomorrow, with tiny jeweled buttons fastening the snug bodice to a nipped-in waist. The new full skirt is ballerina length, and the full taffeta slip underneath will announce its presence with a softly feminine rustle. In this charming Varden Petite, you'll be the belle of tonight's Halloween ball, and you'll definitely be in the eye of fashion.
And now we leave the glamour of high fashion Fifth Avenue, and we're going to move over into the extremely practical quarters of Sandra Gale, where she's going to give us some advice on care of clothing in the home. And I think that husbands will be just as interested in this as their wives will be. Sandra Gale.
Hello, televisitors. Well, it looks as though winter was really going to come our way, and that means that we'll all go up to our trunks and get out our winter clothes and see what we can do to freshen them. So today I have two or three little handy hints to show you. But first I want to show you a wonderful way of removing spots. Now this goes for food or grease, but to show you I'm going to put a little grease on here. Now you see, when you haven't got grease, you have to moisten the spot that is already marked on your dress. Now here we have a spot. On that, you put this very remarkable little aneth powder. You sprinkle it on generously because we want to make quite a good paste on it. Then you rub it into the cloth. Don't be alarmed. I know it's frightening, but you can even do this on black clothes.
Well, Tom Reddy, I thought you weren't going to get here at all.
Gee, I'm sorry to be so late, Elsie. I was on the phone. Elmer, he told me all about...
About me?
Yes.
I knew it. And then he rages because so many folks are beginning to guess.
Well, aren't you telling some people, too?
Why, Tom, you know what I always tell people. If it's Borden, it's got to be good.
Yes, I know. Well, and what better way to tell people who like fine, mild cheddar cheese that Borden Chateau is for them?
And also for them, our play.
Oh, of course. Now, where's my program? Oh, here it is. Here it is. Let's see now. Oh, this is the good one tonight. The Dangerous Man by Lawrence Williams, featuring William Post Jr., Ben Lackland, William Woodson, and Guy Sorrell. And you know, this is the premier performance.
Shh, the lights are going out. It's starting.
Last week, John Fallon has had three dreams. Tonight, he is to dream his fourth. At first, he had only been irritated by these dreams. He had been irritated at himself for dreaming so inconsequentially. It had seemed to him to be a waste of his valuable time. He was an extremely practical man, and it would have pleased him to have practical dreams, constructive dreams from which he might perhaps retain something useful to apply to his waking life. Had there been only one of his dreams, Fallon would have regarded it as an interval of ordinary relaxation, but when he had three of the dreams in the course of a week, he was profoundly irritated. His will was strong, as many people had learned, and he had willed that he would dream his particular dreams no longer, that there would be no fourth. Tonight, he had fought against the fourth dream, which he dreaded would come to him like a man fighting for his life. But John Fallon's will seemed for some reason not to function in this respect, and he was to dream the dream. It would be exactly as he had known it would be. It was to be the fourth dream, and it would, of course, be the last. After Fallon's interview with Geiger and Harry O'Neill, he had asked the two men to come to his home that morning, but before the conference had started, a vein in Fallon's forehead had begun to throb violently. He was accustomed to headaches, but at this time it had seemed painfully severe.
John! John, you all right?
Headache. Sit down. Sit down.
Geiger?
Yes, John?
Harry?
Yes, sir?
I want to start a snowball rolling down a steep hill. I want it to grow and gather weight as it rolls, until it's a very big snowball. Big enough to crush a man. To crush a dangerous man. I want to crush Brown. Does that sound ruthless to you?
Well, of course it's not ruthless, John. Well, you wouldn't do it. That goes without saying.
No, Geiger. It is ruthless. Does that shock you? To me, it seems that the degree of ruthlessness in my proposal is beside the point. I think we should ask ourselves instead whether the means are justified by the ends. Are ruthless means ever justified, do you think?
Why, naturally they are, John. Well, I mean, they certainly are if they accomplish a worthy end. In the case of this fellow...
You want me to give you a time indicator? June 21st, starting at 13.
And you can join in the fun. On each program, we'll call a number of people, as many as time permits. We have two telephone operators who are in constant communication.
13 and a half.
Want to be considered as a contestant, drop a card giving your name, address, and telephone number, and the kind of television set you have. Mail your card to Bristol Myers Party Line.
14.
Piece in there. How about this? Get this. No, you've got to squeeze this too, Stanley. No, you can't do that. All right, we've got to stop. Stanley, you cheated.
14 and a half.
Please? You're in Great Neck. Well, that's wonderful. What two papers do you think they were? Yes. You are right. What do you know about that right off the reel? And tell me your name, please.
15.
you take lead pencils, anything at all, mark whiskers on little children, beautiful girls. That's my problem.
Do you know I have seen that myself? Why do you suppose that people go around with pencils and deface... All right, and your question is going to be
15.
This. We want you to tell us, for $5 and a box of Bristol-Myers products, who are these two famous comedians who are unrecognizable, of course, because of the fact that they have false mustaches and beards. All right, we're going to walk over here and make... My husband and myself.
16.
No, dear, I don't mean you, dear. I know who you are. What I want to know is who are the two people that we just had portrayed on the screen? Did you see it? Did you see who they were? Who do you think they are? We'll have to hurry because we want to give as many people as possible a chance. What is...
16 and a half.
She's wonderful. She's drawing now. Watch very closely what she's doing. She's made one figure there already. Here comes the second one. Listen, friends, and get ready
Six,
for our poll.
17.
Well, now let's see if I can figure out what Mimi has drawn there. The first figure looks like some sort of a native, and it's got a... What is the name of that tune? It's a novel.
17 and a half.
Remember the fellow with a bone through his head? Who do you think that would be? A bone through his head. I got bones in my head. This guy got a bone
Mary
through
Clinton.
His head. All right, we got a call. Let's try this. Bristol-Myers party line. Where are you living, please? In Jackson Heights. What do you think the name of the song is? Cannibal Mountain Music. You're very close. The cannibal part is right. I've got to tell you that. So you have... I'm sorry you haven't given me the right title, but you've helped somebody else immeasurably. Were you ever a Boy Scout? Well, then you've really helped somebody.
United States Rubber Company, makers of U.S. Keds and 30,000 other products, presents Campus Hoopla, its weekly get-together of variety and sports, featuring Johnny McQuaid, editor-in-chief, Vivian Allen, assistant editor, Larry Douglas, and all the rest of the Campus Hoopla staff. Tonight, Coach Lou Little's office is empty while Lou and his team are at Annapolis resting up for their big game with Navy tomorrow. But Bob Hall and yours truly, Bob Stanton, plan to toss a little football talk around and show you some pretty exciting football films as well. Say, that sounds like a lot of activity in there tonight. Let's look in, see what's up.
Come on, pick it up.
Hey. Woo! Oh, go to town, kid.
How about?
No surprise you're in.
Wonderful to be young.
Hey, that's pretty good, isn't it?
Hazing, will you settle down to some serious thing? Look, it appears to me you kids are getting a lot of sadistic pleasure out of all this hazing.
Gee, remember, we went through this once ourselves. Let the kids have their fun.
Oh, look, you have to waste all your energies on hazing. How about the editorial this week, veterans housing? Oh, do you realize on this campus alone there are 300 veterans without any place to live? Myself, I'm lucky. I'm living with my folks. But supposing I had married before I went into the service, I'd probably be living over a garage somewhere.
Hey,
I don't know what's the matter with this younger child.
Down in a sweet shop, a fresh...
Hey, how about this? Stop. We have editorial to get out. Look, if he's so important, let him do the editorial on veteran housing. Look, I have an ugly feeling in the pit of my stomach, but I think you're a new cub reporter. Is he?
Oh, some good stories for the staff, Chief. We have this character cited for the
stadium where once again Don Lee Television is ringside to bring you the full card of professional wrestling. Tonight we have a very colorful main event pitting Buddy Rogers, holder of the World Heavyweight Championship belt, against gorgeous Billy Darnell. You'll remember Buddy Rogers from last week. He comes in the ring with a retinue of lovely ladies, and he puts on a grand show. That'll be a great main event. And just before that, we'll have another fine one between Maurice LaChapelle, the junior heavyweight champ, And, returning to these rings after an absence of some time, the very popular Danny McShane. Great night of wrestling here at the Hollywood Legion, so here we go. Just about to get underway and turn you over now to...
One of those guys from Brooklyn meets up with one of them boys who loves to scuffle from down Montgomery way. That's the first break out of the box. There goes the bomber, and he gets a knee right in the back of his head. Look at this bomber. Tobacco or whatever it is. That bomber Kokovich is up against that terrific guy with his feet. Oh, Mike Ruby's going to have to break that up. And he can't get a hold of Mike's hair to break it up. Now, watch the farmer go. Bomber is just about to get a foot right in the midsection. Watch this farmer now. What did I tell you about getting that foot? There's another one. He winds up as though he's going to throw a baseball and then puts that foot right out in the midsection like a French savant fighter. That was the old Arkansas mule kick. The bomber now has the advantage. He has him down with that hammer lock. Bomber was really taken aback that time. And I mean right down on his back. This could be the feature match of the entire evening.